Hey, Python data scientist. On a recent episode of VS Toolbox, we talked about Jupyter Notebooks and VS Code and how it can make your data science needs a lot better. And this time we're going to take it a step further with Jeffrey Mew as he comes to talk about PyTorch on this episode of Visual Studio Toolbox. Hey everyone, welcome to another episode of Visual Studio Toolbox. I'm your host, Leslie Richardson, and joining me today is Jeffrey Mew, who's gonna help us continue the trend of all the cool Python things that you can do in Visual Studio Code today. Welcome.
Thanks for having me.
Sweet, so what are we gonna talk about today?
So today I'm just gonna show off all the cool PyTorch features within VS Code that we've been building in the past few months. I'm gonna be going out through like a quick demo project. And as I'm going through that demo, I'll just show all the cool features. So if that sounds good, I can go ahead and start.
Yeah, but first, what's PyTorch?
Oh yeah, for sure. So PyTorch, if you're not as familiar, is an open source Python machine learning framework that makes it a lot easier for data scientists and Python developers alike to build and work with machine learning models. And according to the latest and largest annual Python survey and Stack Overflow survey as well, PyTorch is now actually one of, if not the fastest growing Python machine learning frameworks out there. So because of this, we want to make PyTorch development a first-class experience within VS Code.
That's awesome. Got some big shoes to fill. And yeah. It's funny. We had Claudia Reggio, also from the Python team last time, who was talking about Jupyter Notebooks. And I'm wondering if there's some overlap between the Jupyter Notebooks that you can use in VS Code alongside PyTorch.
For sure. Yeah. So Claudia's actually on my team, so one of my colleagues as well. So I work closely with her. But a lot of the features I'm showing today, I'm actually showing within Jupyter Notebooks. But you can also find these features within like regular Python files as well, if you're more familiar with that. But I'm just be showing also the Jupyter Notebooks features as well.
Awesome. Well, I'd love to see it in action.
Yeah. So today I'll just be going through like a typical Python or PyTorch machine learning project within VS Code. I'm going to be walking through step by step. Through the project of like getting started to gathering your data and finally to like the development and training of the models. And alongside, I'll be showcasing all the PyTorch and data science features that VS Code has to offer, like I mentioned. So to get started with VS Code, if you don't have it already, you can go to code.visualstudio.com to download it. It's like free, open source, and cross-platform. But once you actually have VS Code, you'll need to go into the extensions tab. So if you look at the left-hand side, there's an extensions tab. If you click on this, you can search for the keyword Python, and that is where all the PyTorch and data science features reside, all the goodies there. Great, awesome. So now that we actually have everything set up with Visual Studio Code download, Python extension downloaded, we can now get started. So everyone's talking about like stocks nowadays, so I've actually built a simple PyTorch project to try and predict and model the Microsoft stock price. We'll be using the historic stock market price of Microsoft as our data set, and we'll also be using PyTorch inside of Jupyter Notebooks within VS Code to code up the model. And again, quick disclaimer, I'm not a financial expert at all. This project's just for fun. So if it worked, I'd probably be rich by now.
Right? Yeah. Like, I bet you got in really quickly on the GameStop stock.
For sure. But yeah, to get started, I have my project already opened up. I have my Jupyter notebook called stocks.ipymb, where I'm actually doing like the PyTorch coding and the training of the model here. And again, I'm really stepping through the code a bit quickly. So since the focus here is mostly around the tooling, but feel free to pause this video anytime if you want to look at the code in more detail.
Awesome.
Cool. So one of the first things you'll need to do with any PyTorch project or just data science project in general is to import the data set. So that's what I've done in this first cell here. I'm actually importing, I'm using the Yahoo Finance API to import all my Microsoft stock price data. And then to run it, I can just quickly click this run button or like a shift enter if I want to use the Jupyter hotkeys. And one of the first things, once I actually have my data in my notebook, rather than just printing out the data frame, because you actually want to see what the data looks like. Right now, it's kind of, they don't really know what the data is. Rather than like writing a print statement to look at it kind of crudely in my notebook, I can actually use VS Code's built-in data frame viewer to look at my data in a much more human-readable format. So I can figure out my game plan of how I want to clean the data and what columns to look at, for example. So to do so, I can just open up the Variable Explorer. So you can see the Variable Explorer right here. I got the data by clicking this button up top. And then I can actually find this df variable, which I've created here. So it's the same variable here. And then if I click on the left-hand side, it opens up the data viewer, which I've previously just opened for the sake of this demo.
Awesome.
So once you click on this, this is what it kind of looks like. You kind of see it's like an Excel-like interface for your data. So it's much more human readable than having to like print it out.
Right.
And then in this data viewer, it's pretty nice because I can actually go and quickly filter and sort my values. So if I wanted to for example, if I want to see like the earliest and latest dates, I can just open this up. I can see the latest date, or this earliest date is 2016, and the latest date I'm getting is today's date, which is April 20th. And I can also filter by if I want to see like the highest price I'm looking at and lowest price, I can just filter this as well. So I can make sure that all my data is like on at a high level, like as a sanity check to see that my data is like looking correctly.
Mm-hmm. It just feels so natural seeing this table embedded in VS Code. Yeah. Like you think it would be super busy when you say like it's an Excel sheet that's been embedded into VS Code, and it's not. Sure. So it's cool.
But yeah, once you actually have this in this data viewer, I almost call it Excel sheet, but in this data viewer, you can actually formulate. It's much easier to look at your game plan to figure out what you want to do next. Because oftentimes you don't have to work, you don't have to use all the data. So there's like a lot of data here, but based on what we can see, we're probably going to need the dates column because we need to know the stock price on that date. But we're also going to be only using this close column here because this is actually the closing price of the stock on that day. So this is what we're actually going to be predicting against. So after looking here, I can kind of see in my data viewer, like, oh, I only need to get the date and close column. So I can just quickly jump back to my code here and just run this cell saying that I only want the date and close columns here. So I just hit Shift Enter to run it. And then if I want to see the up to date, I can just click on this refresh icon and boom, you can see there's a quick another sanity check that it only selected those two columns.
Great.
I've also written some quick code because again, looking at in the data viewer is really nice and all, but sometimes you want to visualize your data. So I have like a quick graph here if I just want to see like the last 6 months or if I want to look at a range of prices on certain dates. I have this Plotly graph, and this is just showing that VS Code out of the box supports interactive widgets or interactive plots out of the graph or out of the box. So you don't have
That's really when you know your data is official, when you have graphs and stuff.
Right. Yep. Exactly.
It's like this person knows what they're talking about.
For sure. Cool. So now that I have a pretty good understanding of my data sets, I can kind of see like what the values are, et cetera. And it's time to like pre-process the data. So we want to apply some transformations to the data to better normalize it because you can see the values are between like arbitrary values between like 50 to like 260, right? So we want to normalize those values for the model. And oftentimes it's like if you have many transformations in a row, it's kind of, and you usually want to see what happens. It's hard to see like if you did those, apply those transformations correctly. So you can see here, I do some transformations such as I'm trying to fill in all my NA values. So if there's any missing values, I'm going to throw that out. I'm going to scale my data between negative one and one. So I can run that cell again really quickly here. Just hit Shift Enter. And then again, I can go back to my data viewer. So this is why the data viewer is super useful. I can jump back into the data viewer. And this time I'm opening df underscore Microsoft because I'm reading the variable here. But if I jump back into here, here's where the data viewer comes really handy again. So like I mentioned before, I was trying to scale my values between negative one and one. And I can just quickly go use this filter column as a sanity check to make sure this is exactly what I expected, right? I can see that the max value is one, the minimum value is negative one. So there's no erroneous values or I didn't do anything really wrong or weird here.
That's awesome. Seems pretty fast and simple.
Yep. And the next step is, so let's actually have all my data pre-processed. I actually want to convert it to tensors now. So if you're not familiar with tensors or if you're new to PyTorch in general, you can just think about tensors are like a machine learning data type that PyTorch specifically understands and works with. So it's just like a wrapper. And you can think of it kind of like a matrix essentially. But again, I've written a basic function to do so. So I have this like function here, which splits the data into training and testing sets, but also converts it to tensors. So again, I can hit Shift Enter.
So this is when Torch really comes in, right?
Exactly, yeah. So this is actually doing more PyTorch specific stuff now. So if I want to actually look at the data now, I can go down, scroll here. If I go find xtrain, xtest, so here's the variables I literally just created. And I can see, boom, they're now tensor types, right? And then we can actually see the size of them. So I can see the testing and training split. I have my test set, which is 237 items in it. And then the training set, which is 947 as well. So I can see the testing and training set size. And as well, if you're still interested to make sure that nothing went wrong, we also now recently added support for opening tensors within your data viewer as well. So you can actually see the tensor data as well, which is one thing we didn't support before. And also, if you can see in the bottom right here, this tensor is actually three-dimensional. So you'd be originally thinking, like, how do you look at like three-dimensional data in here? But we actually recently added support for three-dimensional data by adding the slicing panel. So slicing panel basically lets you look at any two-dimensional slice of your data, right? So just take any two dimensions of your three-dimensional data to show it. So this is how, this is like way more like easier and nicer to look at than having to look at just like arrays within arrays, right?
It's much
nicer to look at. Yeah. Cool. And then this definitely supports all your typical slicing things. So you can do ranges as well if you want to as well.
Mm-hmm.
Cool. So now that we've actually converted our data into tensors and we're ready to start training, another common decision we'll probably have to make with your PyTorch project is to select the model. And there's different models I can use to train the stock price predictor, but the two most common or well-known ones are called LSTM and GRU-based models. I'm not going to go into too much detail about what they are, just because I'm pretty sure some online article can probably explain it like in a much more quicker way than I can right now. But basically, just right now, just know that we don't really know which one's actually the better one, right? One of the common things you have to do is figure out which model is better. So I've actually trained up, I've created both models just to train them and see which one does better.
Awesome.
So you can see here, I've created this like LSTM model, and this is all PyTorch code as well. And but before I do so, like, especially if you're new to PyTorch, or even if you know PyTorch itself, right? One of the more annoying things is trying to understand what this model architecture looks like. And just looking at the code, like, this is a pretty simple model, but it might be a little bit confusing to some folks. So this is where we're gonna make use of a tool called Tensorboard. And Tensorboard is an open source dashboard companion to help with PyTorch or TensorFlow developers like visualize different attributes or aspects of their machine learning models and training. And it's one of the more popular tools that's actually used with PyTorch right now. So throughout my code, again, it's hidden in the backend, but throughout my code, I've been logging information to TensorBoard log files, which actually that gets read by this TensorBoard dashboard, like I mentioned, and parsed into UI components that you'll see have open on the right. And actually, what's really great is one of the newest PyTorch features that we've built into VS Code is TensorBoard integration itself. So as you can see already here, it's the same.
I was very curious about that, yep.
So to launch it, it's super simple. You can either click on the code lens, so if you remember at the top, if it detects you have any TensorBoard imports, automatically you'll see this like run button here. So you can click that to launch it. Or if we just go back to our code down here, you can launch it anytime from the command palette. So by hitting Control Shift P or Command Shift P if you're on a Mac, and just searching for the keyword launch TensorBoard. And if you click on this, what's really smart is that VS Code will, you can use our current working directory, so whatever workspace you have open, it will actually automatically, it's smart enough to automatically search through all the subdirectories to look for the files, right? So you don't have to manually specify the exact folder, it'll automatically do that for you, so which is why it's great. But if you have some your log files in another folder for some reason, you can also use this as well. But again, I've launched TensorBoard just for the sake of time for this demo as well, and you can see what it looks like on the right. So getting back to the graphs problem, like I mentioned before, it's somewhat hard to visualize it based on the code. I've actually logged what the graph or LSTM model looks like. And then from TensorFlow, we can just go to this graphs tab. And then here you can see the model, but if I can double click it, and I can view like a much more a human readable version, right? If that makes sense.
Yeah. So
just zoom out a bit. But my zoom is like really big just for this show. But if I just close this, you can kind of see at a better glance, like you can see, boom, there's like two layers. So I can see corresponding to the two different layers here, this LSTM layer and a fully connected layer. So you can see here, this is the LSTM and this is the FC, which corresponds to that. So what's really great about this is, especially if you're looking, usually you're not like developing models from scratch. Usually you're looking at other people's models, right? You want to base on other people's models. So this is really useful because you can quickly see or get a better understanding of how they built their model and what their model actually does.
Yep, you're not racking your brain trying to figure out what kind of crazy code do they have to write.
Exactly.
To give me this, get this graph. So I can't imagine not having something like this, a TensorBoard like this.
Exactly.
Right away. I'm personally a I'm personally a visual learner. So.
Oh yeah, for sure. That's why TensorBoard is like so popular right now, because it's trying to help those visual learners with PyTorch.
Yeah.
But yeah, so now that we have a better understanding of our model, we can actually get go on with the training portion of the models. So again, I previously ran the training because. The training often model training, I don't know if you're familiar, but often model training takes like hours potentially. So I don't want you guys to just sit here waiting for hours.
Welcome to the pre-recorded stream where you're going to watch a model be trained for 2 hours.
Mm-hmm. So what I've actually done is if I want to increase the training, so here just have some training steps, which I've previously run. But I've actually, if you can see here, I'm actually connected to a remote server in Azure, right? So my local machine is just like some laptop is obviously not going to be that powerful. So I ran on my local machine. It takes like a few hours to run, but I actually leveraged the power of Azure and this extension VS Code that's just free called Remote SSH. And you can see I'm actually running all this code right now this entire time on this remote server, but it looks the exact same as like if I were just running this on my local machine, right? Mm-hmm. So this training actually took like, I would say like a minute or less because I'm leveraging GPUs in the cloud. So I have like way like 1000x like compute power comparison to my local machine.
Awesome.
Cool. So now, once the training is completed, so I've done the training for LSTM, ran it for the sake of time ahead of time. I can see like how that looks in comparison to the actual plot, the actual prediction. So this is what the predicted results are. You can see it's not that great comparison to the actual stock price. I've done the same thing. Yeah, I've done the same thing for GRU, which is the other model I was talking to you about. And then here you can see this follows it like much more accurately.
Right? Okay. Even
if, like, not super accurate, but you can see like this is just a super basic model. If I had made it a little bit more complex, maybe it followed better. But this is a proof of concept, just trying to show that, oh, obviously this is like a way, way better model, right?
Right.
And then the other way to see if your model is actually correct is you want to make sure that your loss function is actually decreasing, converging to zero, because that's a sign that your model is actually picking up on the patterns, right? Or like learning and converging. And this is where we can leverage TensorBoard again, because I've actually been logging in TensorBoard my training results. So if I jump to the scalars tab, you can see I just have like different lines because I just ran the runs like different times to show you that it's always going to be consistent. But you can see as I run, so on the x-axis is the number of epochs, so the number of times I've run it. And each time as I run it more, you can see it's always converging to zero.
Yeah. Yep.
So it shows that the model is converging at least. So that's a great sign. And then from these plots that I plotted, again, you can kind of see that the GRU model is like way more accurate. So we're probably going to use this GRU model. And then, yeah, once we're happy with this model, we're basically done the project. Like, all we need to do is just save this model. And then from here, you can just start deploying it to the cloud via Azure within VS Code, or you can, and then from there, you can start making all your money.
Awesome. I do like my money.
But yeah, those were the key features that PyTorch has to offer, or VS Code has to offer for PyTorch developers. And if you're interested more, just go search for the Python extension within VS Code, because that's where all the goodies live, and Jupyter Notebooks as well.
That's awesome. So what can we foresee in the near future with PyTorch? What's next?
Right. So I would say, yeah, PyTorch is like one of the newer endeavors, as I was saying, within VS Code and Microsoft. So we're definitely going to be, we have a lot of things in the pipeline. I would say some of the next things, without giving too much information away, is like a lot of data tooling. So things to help with enhancements to the data viewer, like you saw earlier, better ways to basically clean your data, process your data, because that's something that all data scientists have to do. So that's something else that's coming in the pipeline. But stay tuned, because I'll probably be back in the future, because this is like, there's going to be so many new features coming along.
Good stuff. Yeah, well, thanks for sharing that. I think alongside Jupyter Notebooks, Python really is super powerful, and so is VS Code. So
yeah, thank you so much for having me.
Awesome. And yeah, definitely go try this out, y'all. It's some cool stuff, especially if you're a data scientist. It's, you know, feel less frustrated.
Exactly.
Cool. And with that, happy coding.